those people that were blind and even bring a dead man back to life like Lazarus in the Bible. That's what the Muslims believed that I was telling him. He said, you got a demon. I said, what? He said, you got a demon. I said, I got a demon. How did I get a demon? He said, don't talk about them. Don't talk about those guys. And he kept putting the cross all around. Then something happened just real soon after that. We went to one of those great big prayer meetings. I don't know if you ever seen them on TV where you got 5,000 people sitting in the audience all going, boom, boom, like this. He had a heart attack. Now that's funny, but not funny, but strange. Let me use the word strange, because the guy on the stage is healing people, and here he had a heart attack back there. First thing they said was call an ambulance. We went to the hospital, Veterans Hospital there in Oak Cliff, which is south of Dallas. And I was glad because they said, well, it was a heart attack, but he's going to be all right. You just need to stay in the hospital for a while and take it easy and cut back certain kind of foods and whatever you do, don't walk around that cross anymore. So I went to visit him on a regular basis. He was a good friend, and I liked him, and I like to visit people when they're in the hospital. They need it, you know. A lot of times we forget people in the hospital, by the way. It's a good thing we'll do that. And while I'm there, though, one day, a guy comes rolling in a wheelchair because they shared the room. And I began, I always had my Bible under my arm, by the way, and I began to witness to the man in the wheelchair, Jesus loves you. He just looked at me like, get out of my face. And I said, where are you from? He said, I'm from Pluto. Well, now in Texas, we have a Venus, Texas, so I thought maybe it's a city I didn't know about. But he was basically telling me to buzz off. I could have said the word you guys use in Australia, but I decided buzz was better. Buzz off! I tried to witness to this man, and I'm trying to read to him from the book called Jonah. It's Eunice. You know Eunice. We have him in the Quran. Well, he's in the Bible. The same story. He goes to his people in Nineveh, and they don't listen to him. So he gets out on a boat, and he leaves, and a storm comes up. He goes in the water. The whale swallows him. He goes down to the bottom of the water. The only thing missing out of the Bible is, like, I consider maybe the most important point of the story is in the bottom of the water that Jonah says an amazing statement. Somebody copying the Bible, I guess, left it out, but this is a beautiful statement. La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min adh-dhalimin. Saying, there's no God to worship except you, Allah. The glory, the majesty is to you. And verily, I did wrongdoing to myself. Beautiful statement. Right after that, God caused the whale to spit him up on the land. He went back to his people, etc. You know the story. Anyway, I was reading this to him, witness to him. He started crying. His tears coming down his face. He looked up at me and he said, I'm sorry for the way I treated you. And I'm sorry for my behavior. I had no reason to act like that. It's just I've had a lot of problems in my life that I never imagined I would have. Just unbelievable. And I saw you coming at me like that. I just, you know, I'm really sorry. And I need to confess something to you. I said, stop. I'm not a priest. Don't confess to me. I'm not Catholic. We don't do confession. He said, I'm Catholic. And I know you're not a priest because I am. We became very good friends. I was Protestant, he was Catholic. That's okay. When my friend got out of the hospital, I continued to go visit the priest. And when he got out of the hospital, I asked him to come and stay with us and let us take care of him while he got better. He agreed, and he came to be with us. Now watch. I'm on the way home from the hospital, going to my place. I'm telling him about Islam because I've learned a lot about Islam. He told me on the way out, he said, you know, we already know about Islam. of lying. He said, because priests have to study all religions, and we have to study Islam. I already know about Islam. I said, really? He said, yes. And they do believe in the risen Jesus. He's with God, and he'll come back in the last day. And Jesus is the miracle birth, etc., etc. He confirmed things which I'm just summing it up right now. It's amazing. If the priests know this, how come they don't tell anybody? We get out to the house, I introduce him to everybody. And now, I've got a new plan. What we're going to do, we've got a priest, man. We've got an ordained minister, a preacher, a born-again Christian, music minister. We got everything right here. So around the table every night, we're going to pull out the Bible, and we're going to witness to this poor infidel Muslim and get over the right way. Got it. This is a true story, by the way. I do turn things toward a joke from time to time to keep you interested, but trust me, this is the story as it happened. And sitting out there in the country in my dad's big old house, around that table, after we get to eating, clean it off, I bring out the Bible. And I begin to talk about the Bible. But my dad brings out his Bible, and he begins to say, no, the Bible says so and so. I said, but Dad, you got the King James Version. And I happen to have this version. Actually, my dad had the Masonic version, which is still King James, because he was a Mason. And here we've got this Revised Standard. Doesn't agree. It says there are verses in there that are interpolated. It says verses in there don't belong, and other verses are not complete. And it quotes from older manuscripts, and in the beginning of it, the introduction, it says many good things about the King James Version. It says, but yet it has grave defects. Huh? So I'm trying to show the most up-to-date version of the Bible. Then my wife brings her version. Jimmy Swaggart's Good News for Modern Man. Boy, is it loaded up. But to be fair, he said real clear in a debate one time, he wasn't a scholar of the Bible, and if you ever read that Good News for Modern Man, you'll see that he could prove that. Anyhow. We realized that going around and around with the subject of the Bible is a problem. Finally, I tried to take some pressure off of us. We're arguing with each other. And then the priest says he's got the Reams Due Bible, and that's got 73 books. We got 66 books. So where are we going to go with that? So I looked over at the Muslim and I said, how many versions you got of that book you get, that Quran thing? How many you got? Single verse is still the same, regardless of where you go. In fact, every single word is still the same, no matter where you go. And it begins with Bismillah, the rock manner of King, and it ends with Min al-Jinnat, the one in us, and everything in between is the same, whether you go to Iran, or if you go to Saudi Arabia, whether you go to Indonesia, or if you go to Pakistan, or if you go to Maghreb, or Cairo, Egypt, or if you go to Texas, or if you come to Melbourne, Australia, still the same. Doesn't change. The reason is because it's not a book as in paper and ink. It's a recitation that's in the hearts and minds of the Muslims. And every single Muslim on earth would love to memorize the whole Quran. And every single Muslim on earth has memorized at least some of it. There's no Muslim that I met yet that didn't know how to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The vast majority, and I'm not going to say 90% because people do that, but I don't know, I didn't do the statistics, but all the Muslims I ever met, well, we can do it right here. We had a few Muslims I noticed a while ago and we did the inventory. So let me just ask, are there any Muslims here that have memorized an entire chapter, a surah of the Quran, like Fatiha? Raise your hand.
Look around the room, folks. Hold your hands up real high so they can see. That's all up here too. Everybody here has memorized at least one chapter. How about two? Three, four, five, 10, 20, 30. SubhanAllah. Wow. Do we have anybody in Melbourne that memorized the entire Quran cover to cover? One? Yes. Usually sisters, I always find sisters that memorize it. How about half of it? Everyone up here, mashallah. And how many want to memorize all of it? Absolutely. SubhanAllah. And it's only memorized in Arabic. We don't consider it Quran if somebody stands up and said, in the name of Allah, the most gracious and most merciful, huh? You gonna let him lead Salat like that? I don't think so. So there's one book.
I'm going wrong.
And he told us.
One. Never changed. We have the original. Let's change the subject. We begin to argue a new subject another night. The priest is talking about how Mary, you can pray to Mary. We're going, no you can't. And St. Joseph. We ain't got no St. Joseph. We're Protestants. And we got to talk about God. And who is God?
Catholic said, the priest said,
the Trinity. The church, he said, teaches the Trinity. One God. How's that work? I'm saying one God, but I don't know about the Trinity.
We got a little stuck on that one, so I went to my friend with the cross again. I went back to his place. Looked him up, I said, how's it going? I want to ask you a question.
I'm getting stuck on the Trinity thing. I always get stuck on that one. Help me out.
Because the Bible everywhere says one, Noah, Israel, the Lord thy God is one Lord, and you have to worship him with all your heart and all your mind and all your strength.
That's New Testament, Mark chapter 12, verse 29.
And then Old Testament, you know no other God beside me. Beside me there's no Savior.
And who is that? That's the God of Israel. The God of Egypt, the one who brought them out of Egypt, the land of the oppression where they were. That's in Hosea, chapter 16, verse 4.
How am I going to explain to you? I don't get that.
My friend with the cross, to the rescue. He said it's like an apple. An apple. The apple has a skin. Inside the apple is the meat. Inside of that are the seeds. Three things, one apple. There you go. That works.
Now you know what happened by the time I said when my friend were driving along, we're debating again in the car, you know what I'm saying? There we go. I brought up apple, skin, meat, seeds. He said, how many seeds?
It's more than three, isn't it?
He said, and what if there's a worm in the apple?
I went back to my friend again another time and said, okay, the apple, forget it. He said, yeah, forget the apple. I told him what happened. He said, forget the apple. The egg.
Boom.
Egg.
So how is the egg?
Egg has a shell. Inside the shell is the white. Inside of the white is the yellow. Three things, one egg.
Ha, that's it. Let's go.
Can't wait.
Get back over there. You know we're going along. Can't wait to open it up. We're driving out there. He said, okay.
God is one, but he's like an egg. He said, really? Shell, white, yellow. He smiled. He said, what if it's a double yolk? And what if it's rotten? Well, now, where am I to go with that? Well, help is near, by the way. And I need a gentleman while I'm out doing some business. He knows me as a preacher, I guess. And I tell him I'm having a problem with the Trinity. He said, you? How could you have a problem with the Trinity? I mean, look at you. You're the one telling me that.
He said, the easiest example is me and my family here. I said, how? He said, look at me. I'm one man, right?